Good morning and welcome to Temple Baptist Church in Poplar, Bluff, Missouri. We're glad you've chosen to join us on this Lord's Day. Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. How many of us have heard that over the airways over these last weeks, going through what we're going through? I'm actually talking about the cry of many in the crowded streets of Jerusalem from Matthew chapter 21. The day written about there, Passover time had come. The streets of Jerusalem were packed with Jewish pilgrims from all over the then known world. Some commentators have actually estimated around 2.5 million people probably were crowded into the streets of Jerusalem during this time. The once stealthy mission of Jesus, because God's time for Jesus had not yet come prior to Matthew 21, was now changing phases. There could not have been a more dramatic or public moment for Jesus to enter into Jerusalem. The city was surging with people, excited with religious expectations. In Matthew chapter 20, Jesus had just gathered his disciples together. And in him preparing them for his earthly departure, for his death on the cross of Calvary, he told them what would happen to him when he came to Jerusalem. Listen to those words. Now Jesus, going up to Jerusalem, took the 12 disciples aside on the road, and he said to them, "Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and to the scribes, and they will condemn him to death, and they will deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge," that word means they were going to beat him, "and to crucify, and the third day he will rise again." Jesus knew exactly what he was going to meet when he came into Jerusalem. He knew the beginning of what his Jerusalem trip was going to look like, and he knew the end of what his Jerusalem trip was going to look like as well. He says in another passage of Scripture, he says, "No one took my life, for I laid my life down freely." He laid his life down for his sheep, for his creation, for humanity, so that we could have life abundant and life eternal in heaven. This was the beginning of that trip into Jerusalem. The Bible says here that Jesus knew it was time to let the world know who he was and why he had come. Who was it? Who was it that was riding in on a colt? God's timing is always perfect. In Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 and 5, the Bible says, "But when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law," to buy back, to allow humanity to enter into relationship anew and afresh with God through his Son, Jesus Christ. But it could only happen in God's time. Jesus had performed his ministry up to this point. He had done so many great things for so many people, and yet he would say, "Don't tell anybody right now, because my time had not yet come." He was concerned that some would gather him up and try to cause him to be an earthly king, and he knew that at this coming of the earth, he was not to be an earthly king. He was to be a spiritual king of those who would believe in him. Someday he will come again, and he will be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In our lives, those of us who've accepted Jesus as our Savior, those of us who believe the Word of God, the Bible, he is our Lord of Lords. He is our King of Kings. But for so many of the world who do not yet know him, he is not yet there. And so Jesus knew at this point of Matthew chapter 21 that the fullness of God's time had come. He was to let the people know who had come. In Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9, centuries before this passage in Matthew 21 was recounted in the gospel, in Zechariah 9:9, the Bible says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation." Now look, "lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. Now listen to the story that we find here in Matthew chapter 21. Centuries before, the passage we just looked at, the prophet, divinely inspired by God, said that Jesus was going to come in amongst his people riding on the foal of a donkey. Luke tells us that this is a donkey that has never been ridden before. And listen to the story now of Matthew 21. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and immediately he will send them." All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, "Who is this?" So the multitude said, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee." They were confessing that Jesus was the promised Messiah, the one that their prophets in the Old Testament had foretold of so many centuries prior to this, the promised, long-awaited Messiah. This prophecy of Zechariah had come centuries before the events of Matthew chapter 21. All the prophecies of the Old Testament concerning the Messiah were unfolding and being fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ, riding on a colt. There's a couple things I think that we could look at as we think about the Jesus coming into Jerusalem riding on a colt. First of all, I think it lets us know that salvation is not just for the higher up echelon. Salvation is not just for the rich. Salvation is for everyone. When Jesus was born into this world, he was born in Bethlehem. He was laid in a stable, in an animal's feeding trough, a manger. His mother was a teenage, up to this point unknown, young lady. His father was a lowly carpenter. He was a friend, the Bible says, of tax collectors and sinners. And that lets me know that there is hope for us all. No one is outside the scope of the salvation that God has provided through Jesus Christ. No one is too high but what they don't need that salvation. No one is too low but what they can't grasp that salvation that the Lord so freely offers. There's another thing that I thought about as I was reading this passage of Scripture. In the Gospel of Luke, as Luke is recounting this very same story that Matthew has recounted in chapter 21 of Matthew, Luke adds a little something that he noticed. Matthew felt for whatever reason it wasn't important in his account, but Luke wanted to add this, and it says, "A colt that has never been ridden." An unbroken colt. Can you imagine that? There's a situation that this colt who's never been ridden is being ridden now. And he's being ridden in the crowded, loud, parade-like streets of Jerusalem with millions of people moving about and shouting. I don't know how many of you are familiar with horses or donkeys, mules, but an animal that has never been ridden before, and all of a sudden, Jesus is riding this animal, this unbroken animal. And the animal, in the midst of all of this hubbub and to-do in the streets of Jerusalem, with the press of the crowd and with the hollering and the cheering and all of the things going on, this was an impossible, humanly impossible feat. But we must remember that Jesus was wanting people at this point to know who he is. is. Moving about in the midst of all of this crowd, this could only be accomplished by the one who had control over the winds and waves, over the fevers and diseases, the one who can control nature. This could only be accomplished by the Messiah, the Savior, Jesus. It was time for the world to know that Jesus, the Messiah, had come. The long-awaited, prophesied about Jesus was riding into Jerusalem triumphantly with the people calling out, treating him as the king they had so long waited for. There's a second thing. Not only did Jesus want them to know who had come to Jerusalem that day, but it was time to let the world know why he had come. The last recorded act of Jesus in Matthew chapter 20, just the chapter prior to our text for today, his riding into Jerusalem was to restore the sight of two blind men. It's one of the last things he did prior to riding into Jerusalem on this colt. The word was getting out about Jesus, multiplying a small meal, barely enough to feed a few, and with it feeding 5,000 men, not counting all the women and children. What a miracle! The miracle of calming the storms and cooling the fevers and giving sight to the blind and hearing to the deaf and words to the mute, to raise people from the dead, restoring people and forgiving sins. The word was getting around about Jesus, and the masses were now gathering in the streets of Jerusalem. Listen to their shouts, verse 9. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" Today, as we think about the word Hosanna, we seem to think that it was a word of praise to a king, and there was an essence of that. But let me share with you what the people understood the word Hosanna to mean in living in Matthew chapter 21 in that day. It was coming from a people who were oppressed by the Roman government. They were highly, oppressively taxed beyond measure. They were just like us. They had physical ailments. They had family struggles. They knew what it was to fear. They knew what it was to be anxious within themselves. And the word Hosanna, when they were hollering that in Matthew chapter 21, it literally meant, "Save us now." This is a king who has the authority. This is the king who has the power. Save us now. Many of them perhaps were crying out to be saved from Roman authority. Many of them perhaps they had heard that Jesus had healed people of physical infirmities, and maybe there were many who gathered that day. And then they're saying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." They were saying, "Lord, save my soul. Lord, heal my hurt. Lord, make me fit physically again." But the prayer was one, as we find in Psalm 118, verse 25, where the words say, "Save now, I pray, O Lord." They were recognizing that Jesus was more than mere mortal man. And Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he was worth, in Matthew chapter 21, the people calling out to them and saying, "Save now, I pray, O Lord. Save me from whatever it is that ails my life today. All of my worries, all of my fears, all of my anxieties." If Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever, I would pose to you today that Jesus is still the one to whom we ought to shout, "Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, save now, I pray." We could look at that word and say, "Save now, I plead, Lord. Save now, I beg, O Lord." Jesus went from this day of entering into Jerusalem and just a few short days later answered their pleas for their help by laying down his life on an old rugged cross on Mount Calvary to pay for our sin debt. He who knew no sin became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, the Bible says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness." To confess our sins just simply means, Lord, we agree with You. We are sinners. The Bible says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." I would invite you today, Jesus would invite you today, to bring your sin, to bring your sorrow, to bring your fear, to bring your worry, to bring your anxiety, to bring your marriage, to bring your children, and cry out, "Hosanna, save now, I pray, O Lord." Hosanna, confessing Him as King Jesus in your life. Trade the problems that you're giving Him for joyful and peace that passes all understanding. Today, if you would pray a prayer something like, "Lord, I'm a sinner, but I believe You through Jesus, You're the Savior. Forgive my sin and save my soul. Be Lord, owner, guide of my life." And if you'll pray that prayer and mean it with all your heart, He will. He will be your Savior. He will be the forgiver of your sins and the Lord of your life. Father, we come to You today recognizing You, recognizing Jesus as King Jesus. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, help us, I pray. Forgive our sins. Place within us the joy and the peace, the lack of anxiety, the lack of worry, the lack of fear, that You are King Jesus, and You have bought and paid for on the cross of Calvary our joy, our peace, our forgiveness, that we might have life eternal and life abundant in our spiritual lives in the meantime. Father, I pray that someone would have prayed that prayer today, and may You let them know that they are now a child of the King. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we recognize You as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today.